Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Grove. Glad you're here. It's time for us to worship. Let's get on our feet and sing.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder?
Good morning. You can go ahead and find your seat. Well, howdy. It is good to see you this morning. If we have not yet had a chance to meet, my name is Campbell Terry, and I get to serve the Grove as an intern here. And normally on Sunday mornings, you'll find me serving on the setup and teardown teams, on our refreshment teams, and my personal favorite, getting help at our kiddos down in Treehouse. I'll admit, it is still taking me, I've been here 2 years, and it is still taking me this amount of time to get used to the amount of rain that we get here in all the storms. I was half expecting an ark to come rolling down the street a couple days ago. Still, this West Texan's still having to take some time to get used to it. It is our hope and our prayer that by you being here this morning, that you would find two things, that you find courage for living and treasure worth seeking. And we really do believe that Jesus is the ultimate source of both. As we continue in our service, I just want to point out a couple things, highlight a couple things as we continue in our service. First, depending on where you're sitting this morning, either in the seat backs in front of you or on the ground below you, you should find a connection card that looks like this. It has a yellow Grove logo on there. And if you're a first-time guest, we are honored that you are here. And honestly, we would love to have you back. This connection card is a great way for us to be able to reach out to you and begin a conversation and give you more information about what's happening here. But whether you're a first-time guest, regular attender, this connection card is also a great way for us to be able to lift you up in prayer this week. And so if you have something going on, we would love to spend some time with you this week in our personal quiet times lifting you up in prayer. And so this connection card is a great way in which to do that. Whenever you came in this morning, you should have gotten a program. And in there, you'll find a couple of things. You'll find a place for notes that you can use to follow along in the sermon here in just a minute whenever Pastor Christian comes, delivers the message momentarily. You'll find a little bit about us, our story, and how we got started, and so we hope that that is a resource for you, just to get more plugged into what's happening here around the Grove. We have gathered this morning to celebrate God and His goodness and what He has done and what He is continuing to do. And so if you'll stand with me and read with me our call to worship. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm chapter 130, verse 7, if you'll read with me. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for there is faithful love with the Lord. And with Him is the redemption in abundance. Let's continue.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. End is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me His own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Sing that again.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe.
We praise you today for your perfect plan that no one could have predicted, no one could have understood outside of your perfect revelation. Would you speak to us today and reveal yourself yet again? Open your word to us. Let us hear from you. Help us to come to you now and open our hearts to receive. We pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Good morning. There we go. Good morning again. If we haven't met, my name is Christian. I'm the lead pastor here in the Grove, and it's really good to get to be with you guys again. I was thinking about this. So last week, if you weren't here, then you missed something, but we were both not up here. So that's all I'm connecting there. You missed something. It was really good. Campbell was here. He does do a lot around these parts, but he helped us continue this series last week, did a great job helping us understand what God has done through Hannah. And I got to be downstairs with the kiddos, and there was a lot going into that. One thing I wanted to just mention, and I didn't think about this until I was sitting there and we were singing and just thinking about over the years, all kinds of really great things. I've been able to witness my kids grow up. We've got four kids, and witness them grow up and begin to make decisions. And the goal is that they're sufficient in the Lord, dependent on Him, making adult decisions, not needing me and my wife to guide that and be so hands-on all the time. And they're all moving in that direction. But so much of that we've seen over the years is the stuff that has been poured into them through all of you. and through others in the course of our life together in the church. And there's been all kinds of times where they've both the kinds of times where they've been squirrely and we had to deal with that, and then times where they've just had hard decisions and had to make those decisions, and what we've seen come out of them, we could recognize was some stuff that we had poured in, but also stuff that you all and the people who help in our kids ministry have poured into them. And very often when you're doing that, you don't know that, or you're not sure. Because a lot of, you know, what happens in maybe 30 to 35 minutes of spending time during the church service time when we do kids ministry, it's a little bit crazy, right? I mean, there's a little bit of like, hey, we're trying to keep everybody moving in the right direction and keep it all going. And you want to do this Bible study and really help kids understand what does the Bible say and how do I live that out? And there's a lot trying to get done in that time. And so you can kind of wonder, whew. Does this matter? And so part of me getting to go down and spend that time last week with our boys, we split our boys and girls. We have men who lead our boys' classes and women who lead the girls' classes. And part of my time down there was really just a means of saying, I'm so deeply grateful for those of you who are part of this church and help serve in that way. And I wanted to know, hey, what is this like? I haven't done that in, I don't know how long, like a long time. And so it just worked out where the schedule allowed, and I wanted to be down there. But it really is because of my deep appreciation for the folks that do that week in and week out that are part of our church and helping us go. So that is not at all connected to what we're talking. I mean, it probably is. I haven't thought about it, but I just wanted to start there. Say, it's good to be back with you. We're continuing a series called God and the Underdogs. And as I was thinking about this week, I was reminded that growing up, like, this was a big deal to me. I always wanted, I mean, this was like year in, year out. I remember this being a really big thing. I always wanted to win a Toys R Us shopping spree, okay? Like, and I did some research this week, and evidently there are a lot of people like me, like that this was their thing. Like year in, and there were all kinds of ways you could do this. Cereal boxes would give away. You're waiting for the thing at the bottom of the cereal box. You know, Nickelodeon, they're giving out stuff if you get on the right game show. But this, in my mind, $1,000 and an afternoon in Toys R Us, I could do some damage. Okay, and I just so wanted that to be the case. And in fact, I was so fascinated and so excited by the possibility of this that I actually paid attention to the fine print that would come with those sweepstakes, with those potential awards. And it always dawned on me, it stood out to me that residents of certain states were not eligible to win, okay? And I thought that was a tragedy. At the same time, I was always really grateful. I didn't live in those states, okay? I still had a chance. My dream was alive, right? Because in some of these states, they were just considered ineligible. And today we're making our way through this series. We're making our way into the New Testament. We've kind of been making our way through the sweep of the Bible in a certain sense. It's just 6 weeks, but we're making our way through the Old Testament, now into the New Testament. And we're looking at Jesus' ancestors, the unqualified. So we're going to be in Matthew chapter 1, the very beginning of the New Testament. You can go ahead and turn there, page 869, Matthew chapter 1. If you don't have a Bible or a device to follow along, we've got some of the verses. They'll be up here on the screens, but we'd love for you to open that Bible that's in front of you. You can follow along there. If you don't have one and you want one, that's our gift to you, so grab that. So as you're doing that, we get ready to look at Matthew chapter 1. I was thinking about this idea of being eligible and realized, you know, there's a difference between being eligible and being qualified. Those are two different things. See, I was eligible to win that Toys R Us shopping spree. That's what was so enticing. Like, I'm eligible. I could be the kid who gets to go spend that afternoon in Toys R Us, $1,000, a whole bunch of people with carts helping me go and make my way through, you know, the million toys at Toys R Us that I can play with. And so that was true. I was eligible to win the spree, but that didn't mean I was qualified. See, being eligible means you meet the basic requirements. or the prerequisites for something. And so those poor kids in Rhode Island, they couldn't win a Toys R Us shopping spree simply because their state is so complicated when it comes to laws with giveaways and sweepstakes and that kind of thing. But being qualified, that's something different. That's a very different thing. Being qualified means you have the necessary education, training, or experience that will allow you to excel in that role. Now, I'm sure, and to this day, I have the training, I have the experience and training needed to excel in a Toys R Us shopping spree, okay? Again, I could do some damage, I really believe that. But I still wasn't qualified because I always lacked the winning ticket. There was still a qualification that I didn't meet. The person that got to do that had something else. Eligible, but not qualified. Now, that is a very trivial example, okay, of the difference between those things. But when does being qualified really matter? When do you really care whether somebody's qualified? Well, when you get on a flight, right? When you step on an airplane, yeah. When you're going to surgery, right? You're going to have surgery. You care about qualified, right? You're not just like, you know, I'm pretty adept with a butter knife. I think I could, like, that's not enough. You really want somebody qualified. And you think about the importance of being qualified personally, also when you're given a weighty responsibility, right? The questions start to go, am I up to this? Do I have what it takes? Right? Think about it. I mean, just kids. Guys, as you're growing up, right, you make your way from one grade to the next grade, and you're thinking, I don't know, like, maybe now we've got homework. Can I do homework? And then you go from homework to, like, oh, now they're using letters in math. Like, I don't know. Do I have what it takes? Can I do this? You start to think about that as you grow up, and now the opportunity to drive, right, to get a car and drive, that you're like, oh. Okay, I need to figure out, am I qualified to do this? Some of you don't care. You're like, just give me the keys. I don't care. I'll figure it out. But you begin to think about it there. Begin to think about it if you're simply, you know, trying to grow up and maybe buy a house. And they even talk about it, right? Are you qualified to buy the house? Either because you've got a lot of money in the bank or because you have done enough with your money that you qualify for a loan. Somebody's willing to give you alone, allow you to do that. And so the qualifications matter there. You think about it a lot when you become a parent. Right? They don't check a lot. They just say, hey, here you go. And you begin, well, okay. All right. Well, what are my qualifications? And you begin to think about it then. And then you think about what happens when you feel underqualified. What kinds of things go on when you feel underqualified? All kinds of doubt creeps in, all kinds of hesitancy, lots of questions that pop up when you're not sure whether you're qualified or not. So this is a personal question. When we think about our qualifications, we run through this in all kinds of ways. But it's also a key religious question. Okay, just point blank across all human endeavors and thoughts. This is one of those big questions, right? This question, what qualifies us for favor of whatever kind with the gods? This is just this human question. What would allow for us to be considered by the gods if we believe that there is some kind of supernatural entity that we need to interact with? What would qualify us for favor with that being or those beings? Now, our Christian way of talking about this, which when we talk about Christianity, again, our assessment, our conviction is we're not just talking about, well, this is our flavor, you have your flavor. We say, no, we really believe that this understanding is, as we've been doing in our Monday group, this is a picture of reality. It's not just a picture of one group's opinion. This is what we understand to be reality. And so our really the question then becomes, what qualifies us for favor, not with the gods, but with the one true God, with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, as revealed in the Bible, the God who we say is Jesus. Jesus is God. What qualifies us for favor with God? And our response then as humans is we are all eligible, but we are not qualified. That's this basic premise. We are eligible for the favor of God in some form or fashion, but we are unqualified. And so that's where we pick up. Thinking about that, go to Matthew chapter 1, like I mentioned earlier, and I wanted you to see, we're going to start what Matthew says is the beginning, or the genealogy, the genesis of Jesus Christ. Okay, so I'm going to read, you follow along with me, we're going to cover a lot of ground, and then see what's significant about this, just one of the many things, or a couple of the many things that would be significant about what Matthew does in setting up his entire gospel, this entire explanation of who Jesus is and what he's all about. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1, it says, an account of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham fathered Isaac, Isaac fathered Jacob, Jacob fathered Judah and his brothers. Judah fathered Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Perez fathered Hezron, Hezron fathered Aram, Aram fathered Aminadab, Aminadab fathered Nahshon, Nahshon fathered Salmon, Salmon fathered Boaz by Rahab, Boaz fathered Obed by Ruth, Obed fathered Jesse, and Jesse fathered King David. David fathered Solomon by Uriah's wife. Solomon fathered Rehoboam, Rehoboam fathered Abijah, Abijah fathered Asa, Asa fathered Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat fathered Joram, Joram fathered Uzziah, Uzziah fathered Jotham, Jotham fathered Ahaz, Ahaz fathered Hezekiah, Hezekiah fathered Manasseh, Manasseh fathered Amon, Amon fathered Josiah, and Josiah fathered Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the exile to Babylon. After the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah fathered Shealtiel. Shealtiel fathered Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel fathered Abiud. Abiud fathered Eliakim. Eliakim fathered Azor. Azor fathered Zadok. Zadok fathered Akim. Akim fathered Eliud. Eliud fathered Eleazar. Eleazar fathered Matan. Matan fathered Jacob. And Jacob fathered Joseph, the husband of Mary, who gave birth to Jesus, who is called the Christ. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations, and from David until the exile to Babylon, 14 generations, and from the exile to Babylon until the Christ, 14 generations. Now, it's a lot of names, a lot of people, and this is the spot where if you have ever sat down to do some kind of Bible reading plan, it's enticing, you get to Matthew to go, names. Verse 18, the birth of Jesus Christ came about this way, right? I mean, that's a temptation. But this isn't just a random, like, hey, just some sort of formality, fine print, or, you know, that preface in the books that you're like, yeah, okay, great. Let me just read the book. Chapter one, right? That's not what's going on here. You've just heard a story, and you've heard a very deliberate retelling of that story. Now, it doesn't seem to have all the little components that we would tend to put in a story. But what Matthew's doing here is he's hearkening us back to everything that has gone before. He's taking us back through the Old Testament. And what he wants us to see is that the wax and wane, the kind of think about the moon, right? The cycle, the way that this plays out in Israel's history, this also will play out in Jesus' life and ministry. He's setting something up here to show us something about Jesus. And really what he wants us to see is that he relived faithfully, Jesus relived faithfully what Israel, God's people, his chosen people, failed to do. And so he lays this out, and there's these three sections of 14 generations. And that's, again, intentional. What's interesting, okay, we'll hit it at some different points, some other things from here, but just very quickly, what's so interesting is that very, very early on, as he's making his way through here, he draws our attention not just to the fathers, but to four mothers. He names them Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, and then Uriah's wife, who we know is Bathsheba. What's interesting is all four of these mothers who are intended to stand out, right, from all the fathers that make their way through this genealogy, those four mothers are all foreigners. And we're told this is an account of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. If you're a Jew reading that, you're like, whoa, these are big deals in the Jewish faith. Like, these are the Jewish people. This is the Jewish Messiah that we're hearing about. And yet here are four women of somewhat ill repute, not, you know, that's a part of it, but four women who are also foreigners. Tamar, she was a Canaanite. Rahab, also a Canaanite. Ruth is Moabite. Bathsheba, probably because her husband is a Hittite, she's also a Hittite. And so what Matthew wants you to see here is that the Jewish Messiah has Gentile blood. And so why is that significant? Well, in the words of author Sam Guthrie, and I'm just straight up stealing what he said because he said it so well, Jesus came from those he came for. You read this genealogy, what Matthew wants you to understand is that Jesus came from those that he came for. Don't miss the significance of the origin of Jesus, of the ancestry of Jesus. It's not insignificant. It's not just a random collection of names. This is the story of God's people. It's the story then of Jesus, and it changes all kinds of things. We've said that this series, in short, it's about underdogs, right? God and the underdogs. And an underdog is an expected loser or a seemingly easy target, a person we don't expect much to come from. It's someone who, by their own estimation or by other people's estimation, seems to be under-equipped, unpopular, uncertain, unseen, or as we look at today, unqualified. What we were saying here is Jesus came from those he came for, but there's a difference between coming to do something and getting it done. So I want you to see the other thing that Matthew wants us to see. Okay, Jesus is the long-awaited king. He is drawing our attention specifically to how Jesus is from the line of David and from all going all the way back to Abraham. Now, what's interesting is Luke has a genealogy. Luke wants you to see something slightly different, and he traces Jesus' history all the way back to the first man, Adam. He has a different purpose here. Matthew says, hey, I want you to really connect. I want you to see and understand Jesus has come from David and Abraham. And what he's doing is showing us Jesus is the long-awaited king. Now, without going all the way through all of what's gone on in Old Testament history, you'll know that God expected that he would be the king of his people. They get discontent with that, and at some point they ask for a human king, and he, with his plans still intact, gives in to that, allows for that, okay? Not because he's, you know, just doesn't know what to do, but he says, okay, I will show you my plan can include this. And so he gives them a king. And they want a king because they want to be like all the other nations, but all along they were supposed to be different from the other nations so that they could be the light to all the other nations that would help them understand that God wants all of them to be a part. Okay, so, but they don't want to do that. And so God gives them a king, and all kinds of problems come out of that. But in the midst of this new kingship, God makes another promise. He'd made a promise to Abraham, and then he makes a promise to David. I want to just take you back quickly through those promises. Genesis 12:7, the Lord appeared to Abram. He would change his name to Abraham, but he appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give this land. So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. Okay, he says, to your offspring, that'll come in here in just a minute, I will give this land. He makes a promise. I'm going to bless you, and through you all the peoples of the earth will be blessed. His plan, again, was for all the nations of the world to know him. But he says, I'm going to use this specific people to help bring this purpose about. Then later, with David, 2 Samuel 7, the Lord declares to you, he's talking to David, the Lord himself will make a house for you. When your time comes and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up after you your descendant who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will discipline him with a rod of men and blows from mortals. But my faithful love will never leave him, as it did when I removed it from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and kingdom will endure before me forever, and your throne will be established forever. He makes this promise to Abraham. He makes the promise to David. And then what we find is in the New Testament, these things have been, they're coming to fulfillment. And so we hear this about Jesus, Galatians 3. Now the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. That was Genesis 12, 7, to your offspring. And we tend to think, oh, it means to a bunch of people. No, it's saying to his seed. He does not say, and to seeds. Here, Paul in Galatians is being the grammar crusade, right? He is paying attention to grammar. He says, he doesn't say to seed, to seeds, he says to seed, as though referring to many, but referring to one. And to your seed, who is Christ. The promise was there would be one who would come, and through him, everything would flourish. And so, here's what we find. There's that promise to Abraham. That promise continues through David with the establishment of a kingdom, and it's fulfilled in Jesus. Jesus is the long-awaited king. Jesus is the end of the line for what was lined out in the Old Testament, and he's the starting point for the coming of God's eternal kingdom. And so again, Matthew 1:1, literally, it's the genesis of Jesus Christ. This is the start of a new thing. Old Testament, the path is from creation to devastation, and then this anticipation. And then we come to the New Testament, the arrival of Jesus, and we move to redemption, leading to restoration, which is new creation. That's what Jesus has come. He is, again, the seed that will, from which all of this will spring. He is the long-awaited king, but he does something that matters for us in this whole deal. He's not just the king. He's the king who loves us and cares for us and who has qualified us for his domain. If he is the king, he has a domain. He has a place that he is responsible and sovereign over. He is the king who is sovereign over all things, the entire universe. And so he's the one who is the answer to how do we find favor with God? What qualifies us to be a part of God's domain forever? I want you to know, he has qualified us for that. It's interesting. There's this promise. In that promise to David, 2 Samuel 7, God says this, I will be, verse 14, I will be his father and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will discipline him with a rod of men and blows from mortals. And then 2 Corinthians 5:21. He made the one who did not know sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Now, what we believe and understand about Jesus is he did no wrong. I just said he's the king, but the promise was that there will be a king who will lead to more and more and more kings, and then ultimately there's this king that we're awaiting. And when he does wrong, God says, I'll discipline him with a rod of men and blows for mortals. You go, wait, how can Jesus be the king? He didn't do anything wrong. He doesn't need to be disciplined. He doesn't need a rod of men, blows for mortals. That's the point. You and I did. And so that's what 2 Corinthians 5 tells us. He is the king who then has stepped in for humanity, taken on our discipline, so that we might be made right with God. That's this good news. Brian Stevenson, who's an author and lawyer, he wrote the book Just Mercy. Maybe you saw the Michael B. Jordan movie based on the book. He works with the incarcerated, and he often says, you are more than the worst thing you've ever done. And that is absolutely true. That is the good news. You and I can be more than the worst thing we've ever done. But you and I can never be more than the greatest thing ever done for us. And that's what Jesus has qualified us for. He has made a way for us to be a part of his domain, to be a part of his kingdom. Now, what we call that is grace. We sang about it. We call this grace. We call God has done for us what we cannot do for ourselves. That's what Jesus has done. But does that mean that we dismiss qualifications? Is that what happened here? Is God just finally said, you know what, I'm just being a little too strict. You know, I set up these qualifications, let's let those go. Clearly he didn't, because the king who would be disciplined didn't need to be disciplined. God didn't remove the qualifications. Instead, what he did is he made sure that we could meet them. See, the gospel, this good news that we celebrate, that changes everything, that's at the core of everything that we do as Christ followers, is not news that the qualifications have been thrown out. That's not good news, really, because we're just going to find ourselves in other problems. No, the gospel is news that the qualifications have been met, and Jesus is the one who met them for you and I. So as his people, we are changed, and we are then equipped. He qualifies us for his domain, but then he expects that we would operate within his kingdom in a certain way. So just briefly, two things that I want us to see. Because those qualifications have been met, we don't treat the standards of the kingdom. We don't treat the things that God cares about as superficial or unnecessary. No, instead, as God's people, we are equipped to joyfully carry out the standards of the kingdom. That's what God wants us to realize, is that his standards are good. They're to be joyfully carried out. This is the way we're to live. We're to embrace this as a way of life, not as just something that we grudgingly have to give ourselves to. We're told about Jesus, John 1:16, indeed, if you're in Christ, we have all received grace upon grace from his fullness. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. We've received God's grace. And therefore then, we seek to live out that grace in our daily lives. And so 1 John 5, this is what love for God is, to keep his commands. And his commands are not a burden, because everyone who has been born of God conquers the world. You have a different story for you. This is the victory that has conquered the world, our faith. We simply trusted that Jesus is the seed who has now opened this new way. He's met the standards for us. He's qualified us for the kingdom. And we then get to enjoy and live in that victory. And so his commands to live out the kingdom way are not a burden. I know they feel that way sometimes because we've got this native pull to all kinds of other things, lesser things, short-term things. But we've been qualified for an eternal, good, beautiful kingdom. And so we can pursue these things with joy. We can seek to honor God in our living, to learn what he has said is good, and live that out, because he's qualified us. Second thing, he's equipped us to not just joyfully carry out the standards, but also to graciously help others meet the standards. And this is grace. Grace is not, hey, that doesn't matter. I know I was holding you to that, and you went through a bunch of stuff, and now we'll just pretend like it didn't matter. What, right? If somebody does that to you, right? If somebody said, hey, you know what? You got all this work to do. I'm going to make you do a whole bunch of work, and then at the very end, I'm going to just say, oh, you know what? That work didn't really matter. Don't you feel better? No. What'd you put me through that for? If it doesn't all matter, then why did we have to go through all of that? Far better for you to say, you know what? I have this major project for you to do. It's really important. But I also now realize you can't do it on your own. And so here's somebody or somebodies to come help you do what you couldn't do for yourself. I'm going to help you meet this standard because it really matters. And you go, okay, great, because I want, if it really matters, I want it to get done. I want it to be accomplished. And so somebody steps in and helps you, helps qualify you in terms of that project. It's the same thing. This is what we're called to do, is to graciously, because of the grace we've received, we give grace to others. We help them meet the standards. So we're told in Galatians 6, brothers and sisters, if someone is overtaken in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual, restore such a person with a gentle spirit, watching out for yourselves so that you also won't be tempted. Carry one another's burdens. In this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. Now, a couple key things here. One, the point is that someone is overtaken in a wrongdoing, but they don't want to be. You can't really help somebody, restore somebody who says, you know what? No, that standard doesn't matter. I don't want to live out the kingdom way. I want to go my own direction. There's no restoring to do there. The other thing is we watch out so we won't also be tempted, right? So in other words, we're not just going to celebrate this thing. We're not going to go get in the middle of it and try to live it out. No, we're going to say, look, we need to go a different direction here. And then we carry each other's burdens. And he'll go on to talk in Galatians 6, not in a way that makes the other person a freeloader, but in a way where we're helping each other. There's a mutual help. It says, man, when you have extra going on, I want to be there for you. And when I have extra, I'm there for you. You're there for me. And we build each other up. We help each other. We carry each other's burdens. And so we're told in 1 Thessalonians, just very practically, how do you do this? It's one of the most important things I've come across in terms of how do I help others meet the standard, because it can get confusing. 1 Thessalonians 5:14, we exhort you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle, comfort the discouraged, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Sometimes the standard is you got to do something. There's things to be done, and you find that, man, people are, they're just idle. And they don't think that living for Christ, honoring him, that it even really matters. And so they just sort of give up on that. And there, the way that you help them is that you warn them. Hey, look, you're going down a path that actually leads to destruction. This isn't where life is found. Jesus didn't come to bring new life just for you to go the other direction. Let's go. Come on. And it's not just a warning from far off. It's a warning that comes around that person and says, let's go together. Let's do this thing. Sometimes what you find is that people are discouraged. They know they want to do it. They're just feeling like, man, I'm trying to do this thing, and there's obstacle after obstacle in my way, and I'm just not sure that I'm up for the next obstacle. I'm just discouraged. And the way that I help that person, the way you come alongside them, is to comfort them, to remind them that of what God has done and what he has promised to do, and we build them up with courage. Hey, we can go take this next thing. And then sometimes somebody's just simply weak. They want to do it. They're trying to do it. They're just not gifted in that thing, and they need help. And this is really, I mean, this is most of what it means to just be the church. Is that there are just certain things, I'm weak. I'm not down there because I'm the best kids ministry guy. That wasn't the point. There's all kinds of really capable folks that are doing that. This was me just trying to help out because, hey, there's an opportunity to do this. I'm trying to encourage. We need each other. We need the gifts that we offer to one another. And through all of this, our call is to be patient. Because one, it's hard to always know what's what. Sometimes you just flat out have to ask, hey, are you idle? Are you discouraged? Or do you feel weak? Like, can you help me here? I want to, but we got to have some honesty and just like, let's just diagnose this thing. But in all of this, we have to be patient and just realize it doesn't happen immediately. You don't simply just tell people, hey, stop it. And then they go, oh man, okay, I didn't think of that. Yeah, great, okay. Right, that's not the way that goes. You don't just say, hey, Let's just do it. And then they go, oh, okay, yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right. It doesn't generally happen that way. We have to be patient with each other. It takes time. But we're meant to do this. We've been qualified for the kingdom. We're a part of this for eternity. And so this is how we're called to graciously help each other keep pursuing the good, joy-filled standards that God has allowed us to participate in because he's qualified us for the kingdom. You know, at some point, we all realize that we can't be a Toys R Us kid, that we do have to grow up. And at some point, we all realize there's something far more important than the shopping spree of your dreams. Okay? Even the adult or the grown-up shopping spree of your dream, right? Like, there are more important things. And so to that, I just want you to hear this message from the scriptures, both the Old Testament and New Testament. Isaiah 55. Come, everyone who is thirsty, come to the water. And you without silver, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without silver and without cost. Why do you spend silver on what is not food and your wages on what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good and you will enjoy the choicest of foods. Revelation 22. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who desires take the water of life without price. We are eligible. Jesus qualifies us. Will you come to him? Let's pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you for the incredible way in which you have brought about your plans and purposes. The grace that you've demonstrated in creating what is a good standard that we just could not meet, but that you've made it possible to have done, to have accomplished. We thank you, Jesus, for your life given for us, for your resurrection. Gives us new life. Out of the seed of your life has sprung a brand new thing. Help us to recognize that and walk in the joy and grace that you provide. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Healing every heart.
Stop working, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working.
He's made a way for us through the Lord Jesus. We're going to worship him as our King.
May his kingdom come and his will be done here and now on earth as it is in heaven. He is God of all, and we are one church. We won't be divided. Jesus is our King. Lift the banner higher, we sing. Jesus is our King. We are united forever as one. He is everything every breath we breathe, from beginning to end, His word always stands. Watch the darkness run, every chain undone. We have overcome by the Savior's blood.
Set out. Just a couple things. Want to let you know today, this afternoon, 2 o'clock, we're doing our next Explore the Grove. So if you've been coming around, you'd like to know more about membership, what the Grove's all about, you don't have to commit to anything, but if you'd like to come and check that out today from 2 to 4 p.m., we'll be right here downstairs, and we'd love to have you. So you can let us know. It would be helpful if you're planning to come, if you'll just let me know on a connection card or grab me afterwards and let me know you plan to be here, and then I'll make sure we have enough material for everybody. So that's happening today, and then we're going to pray. We are a part of the Clay Platt Baptist Association, and so from time to time we pray for our other churches in that association. Today I wanted to pray for South Liberty Baptist Church. They're over in, can you guess where? South Liberty. Yeah, they're like South Liberty. And their pastor, Andrew Sherrill, and I have become friends. I got to be a part of an ordination service for he and their associate pastor just recently. Those guys are younger, and they're really being faithful and doing a good job and leading that people, and it's exciting to see what God's going to do through them. So I want to pray for South Liberty Baptist Church. Join me as we pray. Father, thank you for the part that we get to play in your work in the world. We're grateful that we're not in this alone. Grateful to see the good things you're doing through so many churches and believers here in the Northland especially, and just excited for how you will continue to work to draw people to yourself. But Lord, we do want to see the place that we live look more like heaven, and to be ruled by what is true and good and beautiful and right. And so would you use us collectively as churches and as your people to bring the truth of the gospel to bear in everyday life? And we pray that especially today for South Liberty and their ministry there in that area. Thank you for the ways in which you've kept that church going, and you've injected new leadership and people who are just really enjoying being the church there and being faithful in that community. And so would you use them in a mighty way? God, give Pastor Andrew and Pastor Chris wisdom as they lead. And Lord, we pray for your will to be done in and through them this week and in the coming year. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys, may the love of Jesus, may the love of the Father, the comfort of the Holy Spirit, and the grace of Jesus be with you now and until Jesus comes back. You guys have a fantastic week. We will see you next time.